بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This will be the focus of our talk today. We'll talk about vitamin D. What's meant by vitamin D insufficiency and deficiency, vitamin D and the chronic kidney disease, vitamin D and diabetic kidney disease, and lastly, vitamin D and glomerulonephritis. As we know, vitamin D refers to a group of liposoluble steroidal compounds crucial for intestinal absorption and for metabolism and regulation of calcium and phosphates. Humans acquire the majority of their vitamin D from sunlight-induced cutaneous senses, approximately 80%, and the rest come from diet and supplement. The most important isoforms in human physiology are ergocalciferol or vitamin D2. It is only synthesized in plants and fungi, so it comes only from the dietary intake. And the cholecalciferol or vitamin D3 is both exogenous and produced endogenously from photolysis of 7-dehydrocholesterol by ultraviolet radiation in the skin. Calciols, both vitamin D and vitamin D2 and 3, undergo a two-step hydroxylation to turn into the biologically active form calcitriol, and the calcitriol reaches the target organ via the vitamin D binding protein in the systemic circulation and then bind to its receptor, which is vitamin D receptor. This is the vitamin D either through the cutaneous senses or from the dietary source, vitamin D2 or D3. It undergoes hydroxylation at the position 25 in the liver to form the 25 hydroxy vitamin D, and this is the main circulating form of vitamin D. And its plasma level is routinely measured as a marker of vitamin D status. Then hydroxylation at the position 1 in the kidney to form the active form, which is 1,25 dihydroxy vitamin D or the calcitriol. The vitamin D is responsible for many things in different tissues, including the effect on the bone, parathyroid gland, and the various tissues. And the main effect or main response through this axis, through the bone axis, or the bone, intestine, and the parathyroid axis. This is responsible for reduction of the BTH production and the prevention of the parathyroid progress. In the bone, it promotes bone formation and the growth through calcium and phosphate release. In the kidney, it increases calcium reabsorption, and in the intestine, increase calcium and phosphate absorption. In addition to this effect in the intestine, bone, and the kidney, it's responsible for differentiation of the keratinocytes, modulation of the immune system, inhibition of proliferation of breast, colon, and prostate cancer cells. So we can talk about or say the bilirubin effect of vitamin D. The bilirubin effect of vitamin D in the kidney is associated with reduction of albuminuria, RAS regulation, CKD slower progression, IFTA reduction. In the heart, control of blood pressure, improvement of the endothelial function, regulation of cardiac remodeling, improvement of arterial stiffness, reduced homocysteine and von Willebrand factor, upregulation of cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitors and inhibition of TGF signaling pathways, and also modulation of the immune system. So there's a classical effect and also many non-classical effects, reduction of the oxidative stress, reduction of the RAS activity, improvement of the endothelial function and immune regulation or immune modulation. The kidney is not responsible, not only responsible for vitamin D activation, but also it is important for recycling of vitamin D through these endocytic receptors, which are myelin and tubulin receptors. They are responsible for endocytosis of the vitamin D, and the vitamin D undergoes either 1-alpha hydroxylation to form the active form or recycling again and circulates or and activates its receptor. So vitamin D is, or the kidney is responsible for vitamin D activation and also very important for recycling of the vitamin D. These are the different forms of vitamin D medications. It may be in active forms like ergocalciferol or vitamin D2, cholecalciferol or vitamin D3, and sometimes alpha-calcitol. Or active forms like calcitriol, paracalcitol, maxacalcitol, and docetaxel. These are all the forms of vitamin D can be divided into inactive or native, and even, or sometimes we call it vitamin D activators or vitamin D receptor activators. Regarding the two main isoforms of vitamin D, vitamin D3 and vitamin D2, vitamin D3, as we said, it is from the animal source or synthesized in the skin, and vitamin D2 is from the plant source. What is the difference? The liver favors vitamin D3. The uptake is 5 times as fast as vitamin D2. Vitamin D2 is associated with shorter half-life, and the affinity for vitamin D2 is less than vitamin D3, and the stability of D3 is better. So if you look for supplementation, it's better to give the patient vitamin D3 rather than vitamin D2. And this is illustrated in this study, comparing the effect of two molecules, D2 and D3, on the hydroxyvitamin D level. Use of the vitamin D3 is associated with more increase or achievement in the level of vitamin D3. So this is all the first part of this talk, which is what is vitamin D and what is the physiology of vitamin D. What's mean and deficiency? There are many cutoffs or many guidelines, but the most famous is the Endocrine Society guideline. They define vitamin D as sufficient if the level of hydroxyvitamin D is more than 30 nanogram per million. Insufficiency means the level between 21 and 29, and deficiency below 20. The vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency is a global health problem. According to the WHO, 1 billion people have vitamin D deficiency, and about 50% of the population are insufficient for vitamin D. And the sunshine is not only the factor affecting vitamin D status. As you know, in Africa, which is exposed to a high level of sun, it is present in 60% of patients, the total population. What about chronic kidney disease? According to this study, including more than 200 patients with GFR less than 60, they found the deficiency and the insufficiency in most of the patients in stage 3 and stage 4 CKD. And in this study, including more than 900 patients, they found that 78% of the patients were deficient, and 18% had severe deficiency, which was less than 10 nanogram per million. And if you look here, the problem is more in black females and less in white males. And these are the risk factors or the predictors of vitamin D deficiency. Presence of diabetes is associated with about threefold increase in the incidence of vitamin D deficiency. Winter initiation, hyperparathyroidism, low serum albumin, black race, and female gender, all these factors are associated with increased incidence or prevalence of vitamin D deficiency. What are the contributing factors for the vitamin D deficiency? Less exposed to sun. Uremia may blunt the response of the plasma vitamin D, ultraviolet B irradiation, hyperpigmentation, one of the most common cutaneous manifestations of patients undergoing hemodialysis, may play an additional role in the impaired endogenous vitamin D senses. Nutritional factors, these patients are exposed to uremia with low food intake and diet restrictions. And the presence of proteinuria may be associated due to decrease of the megaline and cobalamin, which are endoplasmic or endocytic receptors. Presence of proteinuria and CKD is associated with reduction of this megaline and cobalamin, leading to reduced uptake in the proximal tubule and reduced recycling of vitamin D and increased the renal loss of vitamin D. So these are the risk factors and the causes of vitamin D deficiency in CKD and dialysis patients: the old age, the female gender, the obesity, proteinuria, low physical activity, peritoneal dialysis because they don't leave their home, presence of diabetes mellitus, reduced the vitamin D receptors, impaired tubular reabsorption, reduced the skin senses, prescription of calcium inhibitors, and the reduction of the liver enzymes in severe hyperparathyroidism. So the vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency are highly prevalent in hemodialysis patients. What is the relation between vitamin D and the chronic kidney disease? As you see in this study, for the relation between the vitamin D level and the 5 years incidence of CKD, they enrolled more than 6,000 patients. and we find that low level of vitamin D deficiency was associated with increased the risk of albuminuria with no significant or statistically significant increase in the risk of reduced GFR. And as we see in this curve, the lower the vitamin D level, the higher the grade of albumin. So presence of vitamin or vitamin D deficiency is associated with, according to this study, with increased risk for albumin. Cholecalciferol supplementation will reduce the albuminuria, according to this study that included patients with CKD stage 3 and 4 and the persistent albuminuria. The patients were assigned to receive either vitamin D3 daily, regardless of the vitamin D level, when the BTH was above the expected range or the control. They find that use of cholecalciferol was associated with 53% reduction in the albumin creatinine ratio. But we don't find, or we didn't find any randomized control trial assessing the effect of vitamin D supplementation on the albuminuria has not been published so far. Vitamin D deficiency is associated with many in CKD and dialysis patients. It is known to be associated with secondary hyperparathyroidism and bone turnover markers, low bone mineral density, muscle weakness and risk of falls, metabolic syndrome, obesity, and insulin resistance, left ventricular hypertrophy and atherosclerosis, vascular calcification and arterial stiffness, cognitive impairment, progression of CKD and mortality. One of the most described associations with vitamin D is CKD-MBD or chronic kidney disease, mineral and bone disorder. With the early changes of increased FGF23, it leads to reduction in the level or reduction in the activation of vitamin D and the other or the next sequelae of hyperparathyroidism. So we can see that that vitamin D deficiency is one of the major players in the CKD-MBD, in addition to increased FGF23, hyperphosphatemia, and so on. And according to this study, we can find the inverse correlation between the vitamin D level and the parathyroid hormone. The lower the vitamin D level, the higher the hormone level. So it is a well-established association. Can vitamin D supplementation halt the progression of secondary hyperparathyroidism? According to this study that included 95 patients with CKD stage 3 and 5 and the BTH above the normal and calcidiol low level, their way were randomized to receive either cholecalciferol or placebo. As we see here, the level change with cholecalciferol did not increase, but the placebo, it was associated with significant increase of the parathyroid hormone, with significant difference between the two interventions. So we can see that the vitamin D supplementation and vitamin D deficient patients can halt the progression of secondary hyperparathyroidism. Another study, in cases of hyperparathyroidism, they used the cholecalciferol, which is native vitamin D, or the oxycalciferol, which is one of the active vitamin D. They found that both measures, either active or native vitamin D, induced the similar responses in the BTH. This is the p-value between the groups, non-significant. And this result suggests a potential additive benefit of native and active vitamin D analogs on the renal hyperparathyroidism. So according to this study, you can combine the two measures, active and the native vitamin D, if you have a vitamin D deficiency. More studies in the area of CKD-MBD and the effect of vitamin D supplementation on the bone metabolites in CKD in these patients with grade 3 and grade 4 and vitamin D deficient. They received either cholecalciferol or placebo, and we can see that there was an increase, significant increase in the vitamin D level and the improvement in the bone turnover marker and reduction in the parathyroid gland. Osteoporosis, and according to this study, in the CKD patients with deficiency of vitamin D, either men or women, the presence of CKD and the low vitamin D level was associated with lower femur neck bone mineral density in comparison to non-CKD and efficient or sufficient vitamin D level. And another study assessing or studying the correlation between the vitamin D level and bone histometry, they found that the deficiency, which means the level blue 20, is associated with decreased bone formation rate over the body surface area. So again, the vitamin D is associated with vitamin D deficiency, associated with worsening of the bone histomorphometry, bone increased in the osteoporosis and decrease in the bone strength, and the vitamin D supplementation can improve the bone turnover markers. What about vitamin D receptor activators? According to our knowledge, these are the most studied molecules. And according to this study that compared between paracalcitol, which is one of the active or vitamin D activators, versus ergocalciferol vitamin D2, the patients were randomized either in paracalcitol, 1 or 2 milligrams daily, or ergocalciferol. And as we see, the use of paracalcitol was associated with significant reduction in the response or treatment response rate for hyperparathyroidism. And as we see, the parathyroid hormone is significantly lower with the use of paracalcitol versus ergocalciferol. And to conclude this segment, regarding the vitamin D supplementation and the kidney in chronic kidney disease and the CKD-MBD, this meta-analysis compared between all types of vitamin D. They find that vitamin D2 and vitamin D3 was associated with marginal effect on the parathyroid hormone concentration. The use of active vitamin D and analogs was associated with significant improvement or reduction in the incidence of hyperparathyroidism, and comparing the native versus the active, no difference. So the effect was more achieved while using the active vitamin D and vitamin D analogs. So however, the correction of calcitriol deficiency to correct secondary hyperparathyroidism with vitamin D receptor agonists does not correct the nutritional vitamin D deficiency, and all the health benefits of normal vitamin D status unrelated to calcitriol will not be provided. يعني معنى الكلام ده ان احنا يعني even لو الافكت بتاع الكالسيتريول deficiency مش او الكالسيتريول supplementation less effective than the vitamin D receptor activator, لكن احنا عندنا benefits تانية بنقدر نستفيد منها اللي احنا قلنا عليها البليتروبيك effect اللي بنقدر نحصل عليها نتيجة الفيتامين او native vitamin D supplementation. يبقى احنا اتكلمنا على first sector in the CKD which was the hyperparathyroidism or the bone disease. What about the patient out, the vitamin D levels and the patient out? According to this study that included more than 150 CKD patients, most of the patients were CKD stage 3 and 4, they found that the low level, less than 15 nanogram per milli, was associated with increased risk lower time to the dialysis and lower time to mortality. So the level more than 15 was associated with lower progression and lower mortality. And this is a study for the incident dialysis patients. They recruited more than 800 consecutive incident hemodialysis patients. They assessed the 90 days mortality according to the vitamin D level, and they found the lower the level, the higher the mortality. The lower the level, the higher the mortality, and the vitamin D supplementation reduced the mortality in those patients, either the all-cause mortality or cardiovascular mortality. And these are the postulated positive benefits of vitamin D on mortality. Vitamin D is associated with downregulation of the renin-angiotensin system, hindering the vascular smooth muscle cell proliferation, protection of proper endothelial cell function, decrease of oxidative stress, modulation of inflammatory process, embedding the anticoagulant activity, improvement of insulin secretion and sensitivity, inhibition of myocardial cell hypertrophy and proliferation. What about the use of vitamin D? The previous studies were associations between the vitamin D level and the mortality. This study assessed the use of hydroxy vitamin D3 or alpha calcidol, 1 alpha hydroxy vitamin D3, and the mortality, and they found that the users have lower mortality for the cardiovascular, lower cardiovascular mortality. So, to conclude this part, despite the observational studies highlighting the role of vitamin D deficiency as a potential risk factor for progression of CKD and mortality, there is no randomized controlled trials aiming to verify whether there is a beneficial effect of vitamin D supplementation on these outcomes. يبقى هي كلها associations مع levels أو association مع use, لكن ما فيش randomized controlled trials to assess the effect of vitamin D till now, vitamin D supplementation على ال outcomes. These are the reported to conclude the segment. The reported effects of vitamin D supplementation, reduction in the BTH level, increase in the vitamin D level, reduction in the proteinuria, insulin cardiovascular marker improvement, inflammation marker decrease, and still we have unanswered the questions, what is the optimal target level according to the different CKD stage and severity of hyperparathyroidism? Should we supplement the patient with low serum BTH level if they have combined low BTH and low vitamin D? What is the optimal level for different outcomes for proteinuria, fracture, cancer, cardiovascular, and immune disease? Is it necessary to maintain the native vitamin D supplements in patients treated with vitamin D receptor agonists? Should we use the both agents other than hypercalcemia? Is there long-term toxicity associated with maintaining high serum vitamin D levels? And finally, are daily vitamin D doses poster than or better than weekly or monthly bolus doses? يعني الحقيقة احنا لسه في قصة الفيتامين دي لسه عندنا لسه still unanswered the questions. أعتقد محتاجة more and more studies. يبقى إذن ده كان الجزء الثالث والجزء الأكبر من المحاضرة وهو العلاقة بين الفيتامين دي and chronic kidney disease. Let's pass to the next section which is vitamin D and diabetic kidney disease. Vitamin D and diabetic kidney disease is postulated to reduce inflammation, reduce fibrosis, reduce the proteinuria نتيجة improvement في الانسول resistance اللي هو يعتبر الميجور بلاير لمعظم هذه الكومبليكيشنز وده ممكن بيحسن او بيمبروف او بيرتارد البروجريشن اوف diabetic kidney disease. الميتا اناليسيس دي لقت ان في يعني في زياده في يعني around 80% for the risk of diabetic nephropathy مع vitamin D deficiency. This study found no effect of vitamin D supplementation in urine albumin creatinine ratio in diabetic patients. Another study that used the vitamin D receptor agonist for albuminuria, this was a multinational placebo-controlled double-blind trial that included 281 patients with type 2 diabetes and albuminuria receiving the standard of care at this time, which was renin or RAS blockers. The patients were assigned to three groups to receive either placebo, 1 microgram per day paricalcitol, or 2 microgram per day. They found that the use of paricalcitol was associated with reduction in the albumin creatinine ratio compared to the placebo, and the higher the dose, the better the antiproteinuric effect. Another study, can vitamin D prevent the development or progression of diabetic kidney disease? According to this large study that included more than 3,000 patients, they studied the effect of vitamin D and D3 supplementation. They found that there was no effect of the supplementation on GFR or albumin creatinine ratio. So as you see, there is debate of the study. Is supplementation beneficial? Which is more better? Is it vitamin D receptor agonist or is it the native vitamin D? And as we see, these are the clinical studies of the vitamin D treatment in diabetic kidney disease. We have conflicting results, some associated with improvement in the protein creatinine ratio and stabilization of the GFR, and other studies found no significant difference. So based on the current knowledge, despite the widespread belief that maintaining an optimal level of vitamin D might help to prevent diabetes mellitus and its complications, current evidence-based knowledge does not support a widespread vitamin D supplementation in diabetic patients. ويمكن هنسمع بقى يعني هنتناقش في الكلام ده في نهاية الدسكشن. Should we routinely supplement vitamin D deficiency? Up till now, مفيش evidence in the supplementation or evidence قوي in the supplementation be improved الـ outcomes أو بي retard the progression of diabetic kidney disease. نبص بعد كده بقى للجزء الأخير أو السيكتور الأخير وهو الفيتامين دي أند glomerulonephritis. الحقيقة الـ IgA4 بس يمكن من أكثر الحاجات اللي استوردت فيها الـ relation between الـ vitamin D level والـ IgA4 and according to this study that included 105 patients with biopsy proven IgA4, they found a positive correlation between vitamin D level and estimated GFR and the negative correlation with proteinuria. And the vitamin D was associated with IFTA. The lower the vitamin D level or the patients with higher grade of IFTA were had lower vitamin D level. And the deficiency of vitamin D was associated with higher risk of renal progression. As we see here, the lower the level, the more the progression and the lower the survival. What about vitamin D supplementation? According to this study on IgA nephropathy, which was a prospective single center randomized control trial, included patients with IgA nephropathy with moderate proteinuria, 1 to 3 gram. They were randomized to receive either valsartan, 160 milligram, or valsartan plus activated vitamin D calcitriol. They found the use of vitamin D was associated with lower proteinuria, with no increase in the side effect. So it seems that it may be effective or it can add to the treatment of glomerular diseases. Let's pass to the last part, which is vitamin D and lupus nephritis. And this study included 108 patients. They were divided into three equal groups. Group one, inactive SLE with a SLEDAI score less than 3. Group two, 36 active SLE without lupus nephritis, or group three, active SLE with lupus nephritis. They found that the patient with lower vitamin D level were associated with higher activity. And the lowest level was present in patients in group three, which active with lupus nephritis. And according to this classification, presence of lupus nephritis and high activity was associated with the lower level or the highest percentage of the patients with vitamin D deficiency. And again, positive correlation with the serum albumin, negative correlation with the SLEDAI and proteinuria. And this study postulated that it may be due to immunomodulatory serum. So this was a subgroup of lupus patients with nephritis, and they found the patients with active lupus nephritis had higher MICA level. And the higher or the lower the vitamin D is, higher the MICA level. So the vitamin D deficiency is associated with immune dysregulation, and it is responsible for, according to this study, for the activity of lupus nephritis. And again, the lower the level, the higher the grade of proteinuria, and the lower the level of vitamin D, the higher the MICA level. So this study postulates that it may be due to immune dysregulation that can explain the negative correlation between the vitamin D and lupus nephritis activity. This was our journey today regarding the relation between vitamin D and the kidney. I tried to cover some of the items or some of the correlations between the vitamin D level and the kidney. I'm sure we need more lectures, because this topic is expanding, and it's my pleasure to conclude this presentation. As vitamin D insufficiency, which involves both the theorem hydroxyvitamin D and 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D levels, is generally observed in CKD and dialysis patients, and the main consequence is secondary hyperparathyroidism, and the vitamin D compounds remain the first line for its prevention and treatment. Morbidity and mortality rates are associated with vitamin D insufficiency in CKD patients, but only vitamin D receptor agonists have been associated with better outcome in large observational cohorts, the اللي احنا قلنا عليه. And some questions remain unanswered about the indication of serum vitamin D measurement and about the real impact of this therapies on the outcome. However, based on the recent published data, it appears justified to supplement CKD patients with vitamin D insufficiency and use فيتامين دي ريسبتور اجونست فور سكندري هايبر باراثيرويدزم اند هايبوكالسيميا نتيجه البليتروبيك افكت اللي قلنا عليه قصه، بس مش على قد فيجرز او مش على قد هايبر باراثيرويدزم، لا ده في بليتروبيك افكت لنيتف فيتامين دي سبلمنتيشن. ات لاست لارج راندمايزد كنترول ترايلز وذ كلينيكالي مينينج فول اند بوينتس زي الفراكشرز الهوسبيتاليزيشن الباراثيرويدكتومي المورتاليتي ار ستيل ريكوايرد تو اسيد ذا يوزفولنس اوف ديفرنت فيتامين دي بريبريشنز اون ذا بيشنتس اوت كم ان سي كي دي اند دايس. اند ثانك يو.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasser Al-Aram.
Yes, Dr. Ala.
Thank you very much, Professor. Would like to thank Muhammad.
Thank you, Professor, for this highly elegant talk. And we can start discussion, Professor Ala.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Professor Muhammad Nassar, for this comprehensive, actually, talk. I think you covered most of the points about the prevalence, the high prevalence of vitamin D deficiency in most of our patients, the hemodialysis, the peritoneal dialysis, the renal transplant as well. But I know the topic is really expanding, so you didn't cover the point of vitamin D deficiency in renal transplant. Anyway, I think this lecture is a model actually for us. Really, it opens many questions. I will start with a little bit very short question from my side, and after that we'll take questions from our audience. We actually have expert audience around, so we'll hear from them. Professor Muhammad, your presentation actually entailed some diabetic patient and the effect of vitamin D, the prevalence of vitamin D deficiency in diabetic kidney disease, the effect on proteinuria. My question is about the management of diabetic patients, especially with the black horse, as I used to name it, the SGLT2 inhibitors. And there is some concern that SGLT2 inhibitors can decrease vitamin D, can increase the FGF23. And there is some publication about it. So I want to hear from your reading about this. And should we supplement the patients receiving SGLT2 inhibitors with vitamin D or not? This is the first question. If you'd like to answer the first one.
والانسرز جت. طبعا شكرا دكتور علاء، احنا شكرا لحضرتك على الكلام الجميل. ريجاردنج الصوديوم جلوكوز ترانسبورتر، هو في بعض يعني اكوردنج تو ذا ريسنت ستاديز، هو طبعا لسه الافكت ده نوت ستاديد ويل، لكن في بعض الاستاديز حطت بروبوزال كده معين للقصه دي، ان انكريزد الصوديوم. طبعا احنا وذ ذا يوز اوف صوديوم جلوكوز ترانسبورتر 2 انهبيتور there is increased the tubular concentration of sodium. This increased the tubular concentration of sodium can increase the positive gradient and can be associated with increased phosphate reabsorption. Increased phosphate reabsorption will be associated with increased in the level of FGF23 that can be associated with decreased vitamin D activation and decreased bone mineral density. And actually some studies recent reports found the use of sodium glucose transporter 2 inhibitor was associated with decrease in the bone mineral density. So I think it reserves more studies, it reserves more association for the bone mineral density and vitamin D level, and maybe the bone formation biomarkers. And we can say it may be associated with the justification of prescription of vitamin D during the use of sodium glucose transporter to it. But I think we will wait for the studies.
Okay, Dr. Yasser, I think Professor Amr Al-Hussein is around. Can we please unmute him if you would okay. like to add anything about this point?
Okay.
I think Amr Al-Hussein is around.
Yes, please, Professor Amr.
Hey, I'm sorry. I'm on my clinic. I didn't have a chance to listen to the lecture. What was the question again?
Sorry, you didn't.
He wanted your comment, Professor Amr, about the informations in the lecture.
Professor
I didn't,
Ali,
I'm sorry, I didn't attend the lecture. I'm in my clinic.
Yes, Amr, I will ask you the question, Amr. You know, diabetic kidney disease have a high prevalence of vitamin D deficiency. Muhammad present about the vitamin D deficiency of diabetic kidney disease. My question to Muhammad is about the use of SGLT2 inhibitors, el fracture risk, el effect on vitamin D deficiency. My question, should we supplement this patient routinely with vitamin D or not?
Oh yeah, it's a very good question. Thank you for that. I am supervising two MD theses in Mansoura Urology Nephrology Center. We are doing a prospective randomized study on the effect of SGLT2 inhibitors on bone. We actually do bone turnover biomarkers, DEXA scan, and bone biopsies before and after, you know, after 12 months of therapy. We are having 100 patients in each study, one for CKD patients without diabetes, and one for GN patients who are using SGLT2 inhibitor in a randomized prospective studies. So the short question, yes, the studies, some studies show that there is increased risk of fractures, some, not all, especially with long-term use of SGLT2 inhibitor. Could it be related to increased risk of fall? Could it be related to hypocalcemia or vitamin D deficiency or hyperbara? Could it be a direct effect of SGLT2 inhibitor on the osteoblast and osteocyte function? We don't know. So I think this is the first, clinical randomized study that will help us to understand exactly what's going on with use of SGLT2 inhibitor on the bone, not only with the DEXA scan or the bone turnover biomarker, either the bone formation or bone resorption markers, but also on the bone cells itself. So just wait for maybe another 6 months or so, and I can tell you. But yeah, there is association of vitamin D deficiency, hypocalcemia, hypocalcemia, and increased risk of fall that could all explain the increased fracture risk. But we need better prospective study to answer the question.
Thank you, Professor Amr. We have questions in the chat, Professor Ala, about Dr. Masoud Khairi is asking about the role in active systemic lupus prediction and lupus nephritis, and is asking another question: going to parathyroidectomy in cases of osteitis fibrosa PTH 800 before trying medical therapy. What is your opinion in these two points?
Okay, I think Muhammad presented an article about the vitamin D levels in different lupus patients, and I think the data he showed that those who have SLE with active nephritis have a low vitamin D. This is the answer for the first question. If he means active systemic lupus with nephritis, I think the data clearly should just. Am I right, Muhammad?
Yes, Dr. Low vitamin D level was associated with increased possibility of active nephritis.
Okay. For the second question about the osteitis fibrosa cystica with a high level of IBTH, can we progress to parathyroidectomy? I think it depends on many factors, and many groups actually can prefer either the surgical treatment or the medical treatment. If you asked Professor Halawa about doing which line of surgery he will do, of course, in the UK, they will prefer to do parathyroidectomy. If you ask Amr Husseini and he's around, who will proceed to medical therapy. So I think both choices are available, and it depends on the availability itself. If you have a good team for doing parathyroidectomy, if you have a good budget to use medical therapy, So I think it should be chosen piece by piece.
Okay.
Do you have any answer for this or other suggestion, Dr. Yasser or Dr. Nassar or Dr. Hisham, if any of my colleagues?
That is more than sufficient, Professor. Comment,
Dr. Hisham.
Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Mohammed. This is a very important topic for parathyroidectomy. We have to mention that hypoparathyroidism has the same risk of excessive hyperparathyroidism. So I agree that medical treatment would be preferred first just to control. But I think you may agree with me and Professor Amr Al-Sayri that parathyroidectomy may be risky as well for patients with the PTH 800 and we didn't give some medication first and control all of that.
Amr Al-Husseini is not a parathyroidectomy man, isn't it?
please remember that Dr. Masoud specified not only PTH, but he specified the bone stress fibrosa in bone disease. He specified the specific lesion, is in his question.
Yes, but it's unlikely. Yeah, it's unlikely for such level. You may correct me that 800
within the range for the guidelines now.
Yeah, yes, and it's not a figure because there is a lot of figures that may be normal. What I mean that for that is how much is the variation? Not than for example, if you have a patient with 300 PTH, then following 3 months, it's 800, then it go up and up. So I think the rate of elevation is more important than a stationary level, especially if you control other bone mineral disorders.
We used to do parathyroidectomy in this high level, especially when it was associated with fracture risk, severe itching. We used to do this. But as Professor Hisham said, the complication of hypoparathyroidism is actually a troublesome. And I guess we can try the medical therapy first. If we got a lower IPTH level, improvement of bone disease, I think it's better before trying to do parathyroidectomy. Amr, can we hear your opinion and just about this question, please?
Thanks, Allah. Yeah, I agree. I mean, I just don't agree if you ask Dr. Halawa. Me and Dr. Halawa actually are on the same beach. So we both hate parathyroidectomy. Parathyroidectomy is indicated whenever it's indicated, okay? For intractable severe cases of high turnover bone disease and osteitis fibrosa. By the way, osteitis fibrosa is a bone pathology diagnosis. So without having bone biopsy, we cannot, be certain that this patient has osteitis fibrosa. We can just call it secondary or tertiary hyperpara, depending on the clinical diagnosis without bone biopsy.
Excuse me, Professor Amr, this is the cause that I'm stressed on this point, that the Dr. Masoud specified osteitis fibrosa in his question. I think he's speaking about the biopsy contains definite osteitis fibrosa. So he's speaking about bone biopsy, in this case with the level of 800 PTH microgram.
Right. If he has done bone biopsy and if the bone biopsy showed the osteitis fibrosa, and yes, if you exhaust the medical therapy with a combination good doses of vitamin D analogs and calcium mimetics, we have the problem I'm seeing, especially in Egypt, the Middle Eastern country, is you don't usually use good doses of cinacalcet. We usually give 90 to 180 milligram of the cinacalcet, and we have eticalcetide, which is the Barcibev, which is an IV form of calcium mimetic, also that's helpful in severe cases. So 800 of BTH, I think you can get it under control. I agree with Dr. Hisham said, as he mentioned, look to the trend, don't look just to one number. We look to the trend. So if it was 400, then 600 and 800, so probably you need to do something to stop the bit edge from going up. But if it was 1200 and 1000 and 800, so it's moving to the right direction. So even if it is the same number but different trend, can tell you to treat the patient differently. The problem, I agree with Dr. Sabri, as he mentioned, that hypoparathyroidism is a major concern. Most of these patients, they change the spectrum from high to low turnover bone disease, from hyper to hypoparathyroid bone disease. So we emphasize on gentle parathyroidectomy. We emphasize to keep the BTH after the surgery around 150 to 300, because most of the surgeons, they are scared of the recurrence or failure of the surgery. So they are aggressive. But you know, keeping the patient with a BTH of 20, 30, 40, 50, or even less than 100 is not a successful surgery. We have to talk to the surgeon. They have to understand our key DIGO guidelines, and we like to keep the patients with a BTH of at least, you know, around something around 200, 300, sometimes even 400 is better than 40 or 50, or to keep the patient with two digits of the BTH. The problem with hypobara and adynamic bone disease, it's a silent disease, but it has consequences, very bad consequences, not only on the increased risk of fracture, but increased risk of calcification, because the bone is dead. It doesn't take the calcium, it doesn't take the phosphorus. So the calcium and phosphorus usually go to the blood vessel. And even the patient is hypocalcemic post, you know, the surgery, because there is no BTH or very, 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 you know, little BTH. And the main reason to keep the extra serial calcium level within normal is to have normal BTH. If you don't have normal BTH, the calcium goes down. Then the physician will, you know, try to correct the hypocalcemia by giving immediate doses of calcium, and the patient doesn't have BTH. So the calcium doesn't stay in the, you know, circulation, and it doesn't go to the bone, because 99% of the calcium should go to the bone if the bone is dead. And if the calcium is not moving up by giving megadoses of calcium, probably whatever we are doing with giving a lot of calcium, we are only progressing and fasting the problem of cardiovascular calcification. So we have to be careful. So to summarize, gentle parathyroidectomy and keeping a good amount of parathyroid tissue is what we need in severe cases, intractable cases, resistant cases, after we exhaust ourselves with the medical therapy.
Excuse me, Professor Amr, let me ask about a specific point in your speech. Gentle parathyroidectomy, what do you mean? By the other way, what type of parathyroid surgery do you prefer to reach to your target?
Very good question, Dr. Yasser. So we have two major parathyroidectomy techniques. One is to do total parathyroidectomy with auto transplantation of some of the parathyroid tissue, usually in the forearm, or to do subtotal parathyroidectomy without need to implant the parathyroid tissue. When we compared these two techniques, regarding the PTH level, there was no significant difference. We did a study with a mean follow-up period of 5.5 years after parathyroidectomy. The issue is not subtotal without autotransplantation or total with autotransplantation. The point is 90% of patient after parathyroidectomy, they end up with a PTH less than 100. So whatever we are doing, or our parathyroid surgeon are doing, they are too aggressive. They are removing too much of the parathyroid tissue. So what we use here, we use something called turbo BTH at 10 minutes and 20 minutes, 0, 10, and 20 minutes. So there is a small machine. The surgeon takes the machine for the BTH assay in the OR. Then he check the BTH level right before taking out the parathyroid gland. Say it's 1,000. Then 10 minutes of removing, say, 3 glands, okay? He rechecks the BTH is very, you know, the half-life of the BTH is about 5, 6, 7, 8 minutes. So in 10 minutes, you know, the vast majority of the BTH are already gone. So in 10 minutes, he re-measures the BTH. You know, the recommendation used to be decrease the BTH, the turbo, we call it turbo BTH level, about 80 to 90%. So if it was 1,000, he will be satisfied if the BTH at 10 and 20 minutes is around 100 to 200. We changed this recommendation a little bit, and we said it doesn't matter the pre or the turbo BTH at baseline or at zero, time. What we are looking for is just to keep the BTH above 150, 152, 300 at 10 and 20 minutes. And we did a follow-up study, and usually the turbo BTH at 10 and 20 minutes correlates very well with the long-term BTH. So if you keep it around, say, 200, 300, it will stay around the same in the majority of patients. So just have a dialogue with the surgeon. Tell him that this is not a parathyroid adenoma that he need to remove. Tell him that it's not a cancer that he has to do a radical surgery. Tell him that our patient need BTH. BTH is very important tissue, very important gland. So our patient need it, and we don't want to change the spectrum from hyperpara to hypoparathyroid bone.
Thank you very much, Professor Ala.
We still have a question from Dr. Khalid Abu Zaid.
He has a comment and a question.
We still have time. We can take his question.
Yes, we can. Please go on.
He's asking about use of either vitamin D or active vitamin D. I think he's asking about using vitamin D3 cholecalciferol or the 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. I think Muhammad answered this in one of his slides. By the way, Muhammad, we have two studies, one done in Riyadh in Bin Salman Center for Kidney Disease, and the other done in Mansoura Nephrology and Dialysis Unit. However, both of them are a little bit small studies, including not more than 60 patients. We use the combination therapy of cholecalciferol in hemodialysis patients beside the alpha calcidiol. And the result of our study showed that the combination of cholecalciferol plus alpha calcidiol can more suppress the parathyroid hormone and a little bit less costly. I think Muhammad answered this question. Second question, he's asking
Dr. Sabri,
about—
Just a quick comment on that. If you allow me.
More than welcome.
So because I saw and I have discussion with several nephrologists in the Middle East, they think that because the vitamin D cannot be activated because of the kidney failure, there is no need to give native vitamin D.
There is extra renal sites for activation, Amr, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. There is extra renal, yeah. Activation, and also several studies showed that correcting vitamin D insufficiency or deficiency can be helpful, especially because part of the hyperpara that happened in our vision, not only because of the nephron loss, but also because of the vitamin D deficiency. So giving vitamin D, native vitamin D, correcting the insufficiency and the deficiency, the KDIGO guideline recommend doing this as treating patient with vitamin D deficiency or insufficiency in general population. So I think it's still, we need to check the vitamin D level and we need to correct the vitamin D deficiency. If we are talking about secondary hyperbara, we need to give, 1-alpha or whatever vitamin D analogs to control better. But if you have insufficiency, also correct the insufficiency and deficiency with the same recommendation as in general population.
Excuse me to interfere with this. This is what usually I find in clinical practice. Patient usually feel much more improvement in symptoms, muscle symptoms, muscle pains, weakness, etc. after using both formulations, not only the alpha calcineol type, but adding the native vitamin D to correct the deficiency and targeting the deficiency leads to very, very much observed clinical improvement regarding symptoms. Of course, in addition to lowering vitamin, PTH level. Professor Faisal Shaheed, Professor Ala.
Excuse me. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I enjoy actually, Muhammad, your talk always good. This is maybe the two times. Excellent. And I enjoy Amr's comment because my question was mainly the relationship between vitamin D and hyperparathyroidism and either we give it or not. And he answered most of my queries, which is important. Vitamin D is essential. It's important to start even early. And at the same time, we have the source of vitamin D. I don't know why you are not utilizing it. Vitamin D deficiency is more in our country, as well as that we have sun. Can you, Muhammad, explain this, why we have a lot of sun and still we have deficiency in vitamin D, even in general population?
I think it is the results of poor intake. Most of our skin is unexposed. I think even we are exposed to high concentration or high percentage of sun, even in Africa, our skin and our clothes don't expose the skin to the sufficient period, and we don't expose to sun in the sufficient time or the sufficient period of time. يعني يمكن دكتور مجاهد دايما يقول في فترة معينة الاكسبوجر للصن يمكن من الساعة 8 للساعة 9 أو من 9 ل 10. للأسف احنا اللايف ستايل بتاعنا ما بنقدرش ان احنا نكون موجودين في الوقت ده. فأعتقد ده يمكن السبب الرئيسي هو مش أي وقت الصن نكون معرضين ليها. هو وقت معين وبدوز معينة والديوريشن معينة ما أعتقدش ان احنا بنقدر نأتشيف مع اللايف ستايل بتاعنا الكلام.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Faisal. You actually raised a very important question. And this question was also asked by Dr. Khalid Abu Zaid, by Dr. Ahmed El-Bahnasi. And really, I was surprised when I was working in Riyadh. It is burning out there. And we have many patients and many general population which have a very low vitamin D. So thanks for raising this question. And thanks for Muhammad for answering for his answer for this question.
Can I add something very quick, Dr. Sabri?
Yeah, please, welcome.
And thank you, Dr. Mohamed Nassar, for explaining that. Also studies that if you have a darker skin, the penetration of the ultraviolet rays to darker skin individuals is harder. And for example, Caucasian compared to African-American, African-American or black compared to whites, they have a higher risk of vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency. And also because of the genetics, I think we need to do some genetic study for Egyptian population and see exactly how does vitamin D, not only the vitamin D level in the blood, but the vitamin D receptor also, how does it behave differently compared to different people with different backgrounds? So I agree that we hate sun. I mean, here people, white people, when they have a sunny day, they are very happy and they are all outdoors and try to exercise and have sun. They actually have risk of increased skin cancer because they get a lot of sun, despite that they are living in a colder environment. But for us, most of us are mostly covered. And studies, when they compare your vitamin D requirement from the sun, and it's, as Mohammed said, it's 75 to 80%, you can get actually 100% of your vitamin D requirement from the skin if you have sufficient amount of time staying in sun and most of your body is exposed. You can get this in just half an hour to 1 hour in a sunny day, and you know, in a place like Florida or Texas here. I don't know, this is based on a studies, but I don't know about Egypt, which has very similar maybe you know, weather to Egypt. Just, you know, 30 minutes to 100, depending on how much your body is exposed. If your body exposed more, probably you will need less time to get your vitamin D requirement. My last comment is also the food. The food, I mean, if you are eating sardines, salmon, fish, tuna, dairy products, sesame seeds, shea seeds, they are very rich in vitamin D. So the way that we eat, the way that we you know, get ourselves you know, exposed to the sun, could explain it, but also genetics and the darker skin population could also explain. Thank you.
Thanks, Albert, for the comments. Thanks.
Can I add the professor, Dr. Ala?
Yeah, please.
Yes, I could agree that hijab and the indoor lifestyle would decrease. And also, if you think that about sarcoidosis, it's famous that hypercalcemia happened with sarcoidosis, but it's only 10% of population with sarcoidosis have hypercalcemia, and only in summer. So activation of vitamin D is important. And that may explain that women here in Egypt and in Arabic areas are almost covered by hijab. So I think measurement and replacement therapy. My second comment is that I've been asked too much.
You're not encouraging hijabi to take out their hijab or anything, right?
No. I recommend supplementary or even at home. They can stay at the UV at home without hijab, but this does not happen. And it's a lifestyle of family burden, because women are usually staying even with hijab inside the home. So it's a lifestyle. My comment, I have been asked several times that role of dialysis in hyperparathyroidism. Parathyroid hormone is a very small molecule. It's dialyzable in most of high flux dialysis. It's around 9,000 to 10,000 molecules. Molecular weight. So it's smaller than beta 2 microglobulin, which is around 12,000. However, it's very dynamic. What has been removed, it is replaced immediately. Even if you are using dialysis calcium with hyper parathyroidism, higher calcium is more than suppressive than. So dialysis has no role in patients with parathyroidism, even if you are using very permeable dialysis membrane for that.
Okay, thank you all.
I don't think Professor Yasser, we still have questions from the participant.
It is not a question, it is just a comment from Dr. Anagwa Ibrahim. I think there is technical issue in measuring vitamin D. We have to develop another test. Our parents did not have this deficiency. Why? We don't know if they have had this deficiency or not. I don't think the routine measurements was not just like now in the past. So she is asking if there is other way to assess vitamin D apart from the traditional assessment of serum level. Anyone have an idea, please?
No.
So, last one, recommend from Dr. Khaled Abu Zaid, vitamin D and vascular calcification, a double-edged sword. Of course, this a known story for vitamin D. Vascular calcification is a very, very rich story that needs a separate session by itself.
He's right, and if you allow me, Professor Yasser, to ask Muhammad Nassar, you know, we have a high percentage of our patients who are stone basal. They are stone former, I mean, yani they have the high susceptibility for forming stones. If this patient develops CKD and they have low vitamin D as well, what about your recommendation for supplementation?
This is a great question.
Thank you very much. Are we going to supplement them, Muhammad?
I think it is a matter of debate, but for me, I will supplement provided that they have true deficiency and I should follow the level regularly to avoid toxicity. I think the role of vitamin D with increased incidence of renal stones is debatable, but it may be observed with the chronic unnecessary use, especially in children, and with the use of vitamin D without measuring the level, I think the toxicity is a toxicity for the drug. But supplementation for deficiency to a certain level, I think, is not associated with increased the incidence of.
You will keep an eye on the serum calcium, on the urinary calcium, or?
Of course.
Excuse me to comment on this and correct me if I am wrong, that the absolute level of vitamin D, I cannot rely on it solely for assessment of the whole syndrome of vitamin D deficiency. We are to look for serum calcium, we are to look for PTH. If we find normal serum calcium or hypercalcemia or something like this, and the normal PTH or low PTH in the view of deficiency, even not in CKD, in normal, just simple deficiency, especially in the hazard of patient forming stone former, I think we are have a second look for this patient to give vitamin D before we give vitamin D. But if we have the full syndrome, this will be the issue.
I think it depends on the level of deficiency and the monitoring for the level, I think, as you say, Doctor.
Only no roles, yes. No, even if the PTH is normal in this case, with normal PTH, with no secondary hyperpara, no affection of serum calcium, just only the level?
Low vitamin D level? I think it has to do with the symptoms, like presence, yeah. Myalgia, muscle, weak, bony aches. Yes, bony aches and presence of symptoms and severe deficiency, I think it will be justified to correct this deficiency and follow up the patient. But if the patient has high normal calcium, a high incidence or recurrent stone formation and very low deficiency and the absence of marked symptoms of vitamin D deficiency, I think you can wait and observe.
Yes, we went to the same road finally. Usually okay. The same. Present with affection of other biochemical parameters, of the false vitamin D deficiency.
I think the message will be to assess the patient as a whole and regularly monitor the vitamin D level, not for long or not too much long duration for vitamin D supplementation and unnecessary use. I think this will be the problem.
Professor Hisham gave us a solution to give with diuretics.
Thiazide diuretics
to decrease calcium release in urine. Okay, yes. We have no more comments, and this was a very interesting session. And no more questions, and you can close, Professor Ala.
Before you end, Professor Yasser, I would like to thank you actually for giving Mansoor and Nephrology and Dialysis Unit the chance to be presented. By our speaker, Professor Mohammed Nassar, and me as a moderator. We wish the success of this event. I would like to thank all the audience, all our great audience who contributed much to the success of this event. Finally, we'll see you, inshallah, in the next event. Thank you very much, Professor Yasser.
Thank you, Professor Ala. We are honored usually to have Mansoor team in this platform, and as you said, this is what is initiated by Professor Hassan Shaisha, Professor of Mansoor University, and believe me, all audiences wait for the sessions of Mansoura, waiting for the highly scientific sessions, the very good caliber speakers and moderators, and very hot discussion, waiting for the response and very hot discussion, and I am the one to thank you for this very interesting session, you and Professor Mohammed Kamal Nassar. And thank you for this very interesting session and very interesting discussion. Excuse me to close. And as usual, before closure, I am to announce about the coming one, which will be next Wednesday, 9 p.m. Cairo time. Professor Ahmed Al-Qari'i will speak about genetics of kidney disease. Thank you very much again. And excuse me to close. Subah al-akhir. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.